Amen. To God be all the glory. Amen. I said to God be all the glory. Amen. Thank you so much for being here. Amen. I thought you was telling me something. Keep throwing me off like that. You know, y'all know I got ADD, so we can't have that. Thank you so very much for being here. It's been a long day for us. Started about 5:30 this morning. And what God has been doing this year has been absolutely astounding. And it don't take a Bible scholar, it don't take anybody in deep theological study to turn on the TV and know that Jesus Christ is coming. Amen. Amen. And we're going to talk about it. I talked to Brother Sister McClurg on the phone, and we talked about what I was going to do this weekend. I'm going to preach Sunday morning like a fat man going through a barbed wire fence, just ripping and tearing. But I'm going to, come on, all you fat people, stay with me. I'm fat too, all right? I just, last time I was on TBN a couple weeks ago, I told him, I said, good Lord, I look fat on TV. He said, you know, the camera adds 10 pounds. I said, dear Lord, how many cameras are you using? He sort of cut back on about four of those cameras. But nonetheless, we're going to be doing some visiting with you tonight and teaching tonight because there's some things that are urgent. In case you haven't heard, there's some stuff that just came out yesterday. Things are moving so rapidly. If you'll recall, when I was here about a year and a half ago in preaching, I told you that there was a day fastly approaching that Christianity was going to come under a huge attack. Amen. And that those who believed the Bible was going to be branded as nuts and fruits and flakes who believe myths and fairy tales. Honey, we're there.
Amen.
We're there. I believe the Word of God is forever true. It is more relevant today than it has ever been. And that Bible, Genesis to the book of Revelation, was written under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. And you need to know what ground you are standing on, and you need to stand on the truth of the Word of God. It is not enough for you and I to stand at arm length away from the world. It's not enough. Brother Carl, come here, if you would. If I was a church, Brother Carl was the world, we could stand at arm's length and say, you know, we're still not involved, we're still coming out from among them and being separate. But we have to understand is the Word of God is truth. And if you'll stand on the Word, you can't stand, listen to me, you can't stand on the Word of God and stay an arm's length away from the world. Because the world is always moving and they're always changing. And the world is moving further and further away from the things of God. And if you stay at arm's length away from the world, it don't take long to where you ain't standing anywhere near where you used to be.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm telling you? So you have to stand upon the Word of God. If the world wants to go, then they can go. But you have to know whom you have believed in and be persuaded that He is able to keep that. I feel like talking a little bit tonight. Amen? You should never, ever, ever, ever let what is normal to you become common to you. Because once being in the presence of God, I'm going to need a podium and we're going to get started here in just a little bit. Once being in the presence of God becomes common to you, it breeds contempt. Familiarity breeds contempt. And I'm going to talk to you, thank you, Joe. I'm going to talk to you tonight. And that they said, Brother McClurg, they're going to try it down here first, and we can't see the board or the cameras, and we'll move it up top. But there's been some things that's been happening that's been coming to light, and we want to share those with you. I am going to preach this weekend, but tonight I don't know how excited I'm going to get, but I'm going to tell you where we are. The Pope himself yesterday made a statement. The Pope, the head of the Catholic Church, made a statement that the Quran, which is the Islamic Bible, and the Bible, the Word of God, are the same. That statement was made yesterday. Okay? And I know we're live streaming, but I'm going to stand in front of you and tell you that I truly believe that there's a doctrine of devils that is bringing about deception in this nation. And if Pope Francis is not the false prophet, I'm going to be shocked. Boy, it got quiet in here, didn't it? I'm just telling you guys, we are at the end. Now, I didn't say Catholic Church. I didn't say Catholics. I said this one man. All right? We've been Antichrist chasers for a long, long time. And down through history, there's been a lot of people, a lot of men look like the Antichrist. And I remember my dad talking years ago how that when he was a kid, everybody thought Hitler was going to be the Antichrist. Yeah. When I was a kid, it's supposed to be John F. Kennedy. Yeah. Does anybody remember those besides me? Oh, yeah. Go read history. They thought Napoleon was the Antichrist. Alexander the Great. You know, if you have two or three Antichrists just up and die on you, you might ought to quit trying to pick them out. Okay? I remember when Henry Kissinger was supposed to be the Antichrist. Mikhail Gorbachev came over and visited Ronald Reagan, had that big birthmark on his head. Half the Pentecostal preachers in the nation had that Time magazine the next Sunday holding about there's Antichrist. That's what John saw, he's wounded in the head. Come on, y'all remember those. Don't laugh or cry. You know I'm telling you the truth. I remember when Bill Clinton was on the cover of Time magazine, they put his head in front of the elm of Time, and the two points on the elm were sticking up behind his head, looked like he had horns. Ooh, that's what John saw. Listen to me, we're going to get into some teaching before I do. I'll tell you about what we brought with us tonight. But I don't believe the Antichrist is a particular man. I believe the Antichrist is a spirit of Antichrist that will be on a man. So why did all those people in history look like they were the Antichrist? Because any one of them could have been. Why? Because for 2,000 years, the devil has had a disadvantage. He too does not know when Jesus is going to return. So for 2,000 years, he's had to have a world leader like Napoleon or Hitler, some kind of world leader, be groomed in case Jesus came back, could step in the position of the Antichrist. Well, maybe you're not with me, but that's all right. Okay? All right. My wife was going to come with me, and Kyla and Kayla both. Kayla made it because Renee and Kyla at the home. We want you to write down a name. The name is Myrna. There's a Y in there somewhere. I think it's M-Y-R-N-A, I think. It's Myrna Scott. Friends of ours, her and her husband pastor church in Charleston, Arkansas, Life Church. And as a matter of fact, Sam and Tina, no, Myrna and Terry, met them this past March. Myrna was having some chest pains this past Monday night, and so they took her to the emergency room in Fort Smith. And they kept her about 8 o'clock, 9, 10, 11, the rest of the night in the emergency room. They put her in a room on Tuesday. And they'd done all kinds of tests and put her through the mill and came back and told her she had stage 4 cancer. Now listen, let me tell you something. There is an attack, and I'm going to be preaching Sunday morning. Whatever you do, you get here Sunday morning because I'm going to talk to you about prayer. Something very strange happened to me on February the 5th of this year. And I'm going to be sharing with you. I was supposed to die that day and have absolute, well, we'll get into it later. But there's an attack upon the ministry. Amen. There's an attack upon the authority of God. And it is absolutely demonic. And if you don't understand your enemy, if you don't understand that you are in a struggle, you're going to get your head cut off and don't even know you're in a fight. Okay? Now, I don't believe we are the army of God. I didn't mean literally cut off, although they're cutting people's heads off. I'm not getting to that. But you're still what I'm saying. I don't believe that we are the army of God. I believe we are the children of God. Okay? I believe the army of God, I can show you 90 plus scriptures in the Bible that shows that angels are the army of God. Okay? But we are what I would call civil defense. We're to hold the line till the army shows up. Prayer is your 911 call. And when you dial 911, you just hold the line. Trust me, they gonna show up. And prayer has become, I feel the Holy Ghost in this weekend. Amen. I feel that in this weekend. Amen. And I am more stirred up in my spirit than I have ever been in 33 years of preaching. Because I'm telling you guys, as sure as I'm standing in front of you, Jesus Christ is coming. You ain't got 10 years left. You ain't got 20 years left. I'm telling you, we are at the end. Now, whether you believe in a rapture or not is irrelevant. I do believe there's going to be a resurrection. I do believe the dead in Christ shall rise. I do believe we're going to be caught up to meet them in the air, and so shall we ever be, not ever be in the air, so shall we ever be in that form with the Lord. Okay? But you got to understand, things are about to get tough. They're about to get tough. And over a year ago, I came here and talked to you on this very whiteboard about the God's time clock, and talked to you about where that we are on God's time clock. We are now teaching with the help of Brother Sam, Daniel Smith, and Sam Hughes, Ruth Ann Crosby, several different people, research I'm putting together, Brother Kevin Woodard, which will be up next week, I think. We are finishing up the book this next week called God's Time Clock, because I believe that we're going to be here for a little while. I believe we've got a few more months. Says, Brother Caldwell, are you trying to put a date on the return of Jesus? I'm not, but I'm telling you it's soon. I'm telling you, dude, it's... If I was you, and I was in this house, and I wasn't where I need to be with God, you'd be a fool to walk out that door now without making your heart right with God. So I'm telling you guys, this thing is serious. This thing is serious. And they've literally being truth haters. Love of her pleasures more than lovers of God. And if you go over and you read what it says in the last day is going to happen, I'm telling you whether, and I know I've heard, you've heard all your life, and I've heard all my life, that we're living in the last days. I'm going to try to explain a little bit of that to you tonight. About, you can tell it's just in my spirit. I hadn't even got to my product yet. And I'm going to get to that. Don't worry about it. I'm going to get to that and tell you what we're doing. But we did, what I was going to tell you, is we did just finish up. We just finished up two DVD series. As a matter of fact, it's they're putting the opening and closing on it now. It'll be at the Duplicators in Dallas, Texas next week. And I never take pre-orders, but if you want to order those before this weekend is over, we'll make that available to you. And what is on that is what I'm going to be teaching. Now, we're live on the internet. Is that correct? Okay, all right. So thank you for those of you who have joined us by the internet. And I believe that things are about to get really rough. I believe before the end of August, and I would tell you right now, if you have money wrapped up in the stock market, you need to get it out. You need to get it out before the middle of September. I would do it before the end of next month. Because I believe, not only do I believe it is imminent that there is a financial collapse that is coming to this nation, because America cannot be found in prophecy, and there's reasons why for that. So get your Bibles out tonight. Go to the book of Luke, chapter number 13. Kayla, hand me some of that stuff here, and let's talk just a little bit about it. I believe when I was here, I don't know, Joe, you and Robin, your brother, Sister McClurg may have to help me. I think I preached here a message on the covenant of God. And I talked about Jonathan and David, and I walked through the covenants. And okay, all right. I preached that message at, I believe this is at Abba's house. Is that correct? Okay. In Chattanooga. And we have it on DVD and have it on CD. So you can watch it or you can just listen to it. I think we might have had these when we were here last time. If we didn't, they're available to you now, and we've got them there. Now, I don't want you to think that there's something physically wrong with me. I'll cover that Sunday morning. But if you see me stumble just a little bit, it's all good. It's all fine. I'm really tired, okay? And I know some of y'all's done giggling because you've seen it a couple of times. I'm tired. The anointing hits, I'll be better, all right? Since TBN has been airing and having us to speak, our schedule has skyrocketed. I thought we were busy before. Last year is the busiest year we have ever had, and we've already surpassed that in 2015. But people say, well, you need to get rest, and I'm going to take care of my body, take care of myself, because, you can't spread the word if you're dead. The Bible makes it very clear that God gives his beloved sleep. I used to say sleep is for quitters, but then I passed 50 a few years ago, and I've learned a few things once you pass 50. Some of the non-spiritual things I've learned, for all you younger guys here, once you pass 50, never pass a restroom. Just let us share that with you, amen? All you guys older than 50, help me right now, all right? Because you will turn around and go back, I promise you, all right? This one here is called A Dwelling Place of God. I think this was at Pastor Hagee's, I'm not even sure, I don't know anymore. We're preaching and going so much, but it's called Dwelling Place of God. They'll walk you through the tabernacle in the wilderness and how much it cost on that, the tabernacle wilderness, and where Moses received the finances and what that tabernacle represents. It represents Jesus Christ. He fulfilled that tabernacle on the cross of Calvary, and then we became the tabernacle of God. A series that we have gotten that we've had for quite some time, it's on the life of David. It's called When a Saint Acts Like a Savage. Now, there are quite a few different revelations that I've preached since we taught this series on the life of David. David was, born of an affair that his father Jesse had with a slave woman that worked for him. Now, I know that doesn't set well with a lot of church folk. If you have a problem with that and you just don't want to take my word of the years of study, you come to me after church and I'll just show you the scriptures. You put the scriptures together. David was the product of an affair that his father Jesse had with a slave woman. David was not of the same, he did not have the same mother as his brothers. Okay, he was shorter. His brothers and his dad was tall, like Saul. They were tall people and they were good-looking people. And David was a little rough-looking. He's a good-looking guy, but he's a little rough-looking, and he was short. So I'm heavily anointed. Amen. I don't know. All right, where did I come from? But this is being transcribed into a book. And we're going to try to have that as soon as we can. I quit making promises on when books are going to come out. This is our God's Time Clock series. This is the entire series of God's Time Clock. There's over 6 hours of me teaching with a whiteboard in here. We recorded it last year. We had these ones here last year. This series is a $100 bill for the entire 6.5 hours. It's a little less than 6.5 hours, maybe a little over, I'm not sure, but I know it's well over 6 hours. So these are available to you back there. We brought 15 or 16 of them with us because we're here. Y'all don't have Sunday night service, do you? Y'all do have Sunday night service, okay? Y'all be here Sunday night. Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, I'm going to be preaching, not teaching, but preaching somewhere. Somewhere, Lakeview, Lakeside, Free Will Baptist Church, Staffordsville, Kentucky. Do y'all know where that's at? Because I haven't a clue. All right? Staffordsville, it's on Pickle Point. Pickle Fork. But y'all kind of hurting for names up there, ain't you? Alrighty. Yeah. Stop and ask for directions. That's all I can tell you. No, don't. I stopped one time on Welcome Hill and asked a guy where Welcome Hill Assembly God Church was. He said, well, here's what you do. He said, you go down there, and he said, go a couple of miles down there, and he said, there's a big white house on the right. He said, got a big white slat fence, so usually got a bunch of horses out there. And he said, it's on the right. And I said, yeah. He said, well, that's not it. You want to go past that. And I looked at him and he said, now you go on down and on the left, there'll be a driveway. And they've got half wagon wheels stuck on each driveway. Well, you want to go past that. I said, okay. He said, you go down a little further before you get to the curve. There'll be a house on the left. And it's got shingles on it for siding. It did. This is Arkansas. All right. Don't laugh. You live in Kentucky. And he said, when you pass that house, he said, when you go around that curve, make sure there's nobody behind you. When you get around that curve, put on your brakes, look in your mirror, and you'll see a gravel road behind you. That's the one you need to be on. My hand before God, that happened. Okay. So I did. I got around the curve, stopped, looked in my rearview mirror, saw the gravel road. You couldn't see it go around the curve because it dropped off like that. You had to go around the curve and look in your mirror. Got it. All right. Life-changing truth. Yeah, don't stop and ask for Pickles Gap and Fork and everything else, all right? Life-changing truth about the kingdom of God. It's our first book. We now have it. It's called I Know a Secret. And we are official. We have stamps. We've even got a UPC barcode on the back. It's we have our own personal mark of the beast right here on the back. And oh, it's a joke lighting up. All right. And up here in the corner, it says this book is $19.99. Please don't write a check for $19.99. This book is $20. Okay. And for an extra penny, I'll even sign it. So it's very obvious. If I'm just going to take an extra penny, then I don't need your 2 cents worth. All right. There you go. Kayla, you're going to have to run back there to my briefcase and bring it up here to the front seat so I can get some stuff out of it that I didn't get. Guys, I'm very, very excited. Very, very excited about where that we are. I am a little bit apprehensive about what is going on in our world today. When you have leadership, or the lack of, doesn't matter whether you're Republican, Democrat, I'm not here to argue with you, but this country has never been in a worse position for leadership in the history of this nation than it is right now. And just tell you that we are ripe for somebody to step on the scene to lead the world globally. We're ripe. You better start paying attention. It's not a fearful thing. It's an exciting thing. The Bible makes it very clear in 2 Timothy chapter 3, this know also on the last days perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection. What the Supreme Court done just a few weeks ago is beyond disgraceful. Okay? And it has become against the law in this nation. It has become against the law. It is now a law passed by the Congress in 2006, signed into law by the man that lives in the White House right now. It's been signed into law that it is against the law for a preacher to stand in a pulpit in front of a congregation and to say that homosexuality is a sin. That, in this nation, is against the law. So I have to be very careful when I speak, because we're live on the internet. And I want you to hear me and get this really clear. Homosexuality is a sin. It's a sin. God does not hate the homosexual. God does not despise even the person that commits the act. It is the product, the sin, that God despises. And I will love you just as you are. But don't think I'm not going to try to get you right. See, we have a problem in this nation that if you say something that someone disagrees with, they say you're judging me. Okay? Now, let me explain something to you. You need to understand the difference between judging someone, judgment, and character. Here's what it is. Let's say if Brother Winston McClurg came in tonight, and I looked at him and I said, look at there. There's an old drunken sot. He's a wine bibber. See, I would be judging him because I have no grounds for that. Now, Brother Winston came in tonight, and he had a fifth of whiskey in his right hand, and he had a six-pack of beer in his left hand, and he was smelled like a beer brewery. If I said, there's an old drunk, I'm not judging him. I'm assessing him.
Amen.
So, see, stop hollering, I'm judging you, if you're doing what I'm saying. Amen? So well, don't, you know, you need to accept me for who I am. Great. I'll do that. I will accept you just as you are. But the problem is you're not looking for my acceptance. You're looking for my approval.
Amen.
And that you ain't going to get. Because sin is still sin.
Amen.
Wrong is still wrong. And there is a God that is going to judge each and every person that has ever lived.
Amen?
Amen? And to be covered legally, I can say anything I want to say as long as I'm 3 foot from a pulpit.
Yeah.
Now, if I'm behind the pulpit, I'm mixing politics and religion.
Yeah.
But if I'm out from behind the pulpit, according to the law, this is a gathering of people. This is still a free country at this juncture. Don't know how much longer it'll be, but it is at this point, and I've got a microphone, it's a gathering. I've got a right to legally say what I want to say because it's called the freedom of speech. So if you disagree with something I say tonight, when you get your service and a microphone, you can say what you want to. But tonight, this is my show. All right? So now we've got that out of the way. He says, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Now, this is not my sermon tonight, but I just was in my spirit. When you read 2 Timothy chapter 3, the first 5 verses, it gives you a list of sinful things that just 15 years ago, we are dealing with things today we would have never dreamed. If someone would have told you in the year of 2000 or 2001 that we would be where we are as a nation today, you'd have said, you're crazy. But I'm telling you something, it's just getting started. It's picking up pace. So you got to be ready. Okay? But see, when I looked at this and I saw this, the list of things, you know, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, without natural affection, blasphemers. Amazingly enough, between blasphemers and without natural affection, okay, between those two things listed that was going to happen in the last days, there's a word that if I was writing that scripture, I probably would not have written down because it looks like it don't even fit. Between blasphemers and without natural affection, there's a word that says unthankful. Now you hear me. He said in the last days, there'll be blasphemers. There'll be men with men, women with women. But he said, you need to understand, I'm going to list something in there that I record just as bad and look as just as bad as all of it, and that's unthankful. I don't know about you, but I'd give an altar call right now. I got 4 great, wonderful children, and one of the first words my kids learned how to say was thank you.
Yeah.
But I've learned over the years you can say thank you without being thankful.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we just yak. You know, a lot of people talk a lot but don't say very much. And we can just yak and yak and yak and yak and yak. And I challenge you for the next few weeks, when you get down to prayer, because I'm going to tell you something, prayer is coming back in a tidal wave. Okay? I'm going to be preaching unless God changed mine on it Sunday morning about prayer and the importance of it. But I'm telling you, before you ask anything, I want you just to be thankful. Amen. There's not one day that's gone by since February the 5th that I have not opened my eyes, whether it be 5 o'clock in the morning or 11 o'clock in the morning, doesn't matter. If I go to bed at 5, I'm probably going to get up at noon. Don't judge. If I went to bed at 7:30 at night, I'd be up at 5 too.
That's right.
All right? Don't matter when I, whenever my eyes open, since February the 5th, I have said, thank you, Lord, for my health. I don't care if I had to shuffle my feet, if I'm still mobile. Papa Johnson told me years ago, son, as long as you got arms, you fight the devil.
Amen.
If they cut your arms off, kick him.
Amen.
If they cut your legs off, bite him.
Amen.
If they pull your teeth, son, just gum them till you're dead. Amen? Don't ever quit. Don't ever quit. All right, let's talk about where we are. How about y'all want to learn where we are? Y'all want to learn a little something? All right. Get your Bibles out, like I said, and let's go over to the book of Luke, chapter number 13. Let me back my scriptures up here just a little bit. I went too far. We're going to bring that board over here. Just go ahead. Yeah, Daniel, if you don't mind, just roll it over here. Joe, whatever y'all need to do. I'm going to have to cover a little bit of ground that I'd covered here a little bit before to make sure you're in remembrance. And I'm going to hold that off till tomorrow night because there's no way that's going to. Let's just work on this one right here. Is it okay with you, Daniel, if I work on this one?
Yeah.
All right, thanks. All right, let's check it. Well, you're standing around like you was going to help me. I didn't know what you was doing. Man. We're here to talk tonight. We're here to learn, okay? Don't know how much writing I'm going to do, but I'm going to do some talking first. Luke chapter number 13, stand to your feet if you would. Let's read just a little bit. And the first 5 verses, there's some very interesting stuff. First 5 verses of Luke chapter 13 can tell you why bad things happen to good people. Okay? There's bad things sometimes that happen. And people start off and say, well, I just don't understand why God's putting me through this. Hush. Just hush. It's easy to stand on the outside. This week, this has really hit home. It's easy to stand on the outside and tell somebody how to have faith. But baby, when it comes home, you got to know who you really believed in. So the first 5 verses, it talks about a tower that fell, and there's some numbers there that's very, very important, okay? Verse 6, the Bible says that he, Jesus, spake also this parable. Certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon, thank you, Lord, and found none. Then said he unto the dresser, now this is a parable he's telling. A lot of people tell that Jesus done this, but Jesus told this and said there was a man that had a fig tree in the vineyard and he came looking for fruit and none. And he said to the dresser, the worker of the vineyard, the worker of the orchard, if you would, or the field, the crops. He said to the dresser of the vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why cumber it to the ground? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also till I dig about it and dung it. Now watch what he says. And if it bear fruit, well, then good. That's great. But if not, then after that, thou shalt cut it down. And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. Behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and was bowed together and could in no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And he laid his hands on her and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. And the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation because that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day. That is retarded. And said unto the people, there are 6 days in which men ought to work. In them, therefore, come and be healed, not on the Sabbath day. The Lord then said, Jesus answered him and said, you hypocrite, doth not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or his ass from the stall, lead him away to water him? And ought not this woman being, here's something very important, you should, if you're a Bible marker, you should underline this phrase, being a daughter of Abraham. And ought not this woman being a daughter of Abraham, who Satan hath bound, lo these, here it is again, 18 years, third time in 16 verses that number's been brought up. These 18 years be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day. And when he had said these things, all his adversaries were ashamed. And all the people rejoiced for all the glorious things that were done by him. Father, I thank you, Lord, tonight. I thank you for what I feel in this place, Lord. There's such a hunger here at the house of prayer that we just want to know, Lord. We just want to know. Help us to search our hearts tonight. And Lord, remind us of the old hymnal, cleanse me, search me, O God. Father, let that be our prayer. And we know that you are soon to return. Help me now, God, in this hour to be the prophet that you have called me to be. And we give you praise and glory and honor in the wonderful name of Jesus. Everybody glad you're saved, shout amen.
Amen.
Grab yourself a seat and let's talk just a little bit. I want you to pick your Bibles up. And I want you to go over to the book of Matthew, chapter number 24. I've read to you the parable of the fig tree. And it goes as such, and I won't repeat the whole scriptures, but the parable of the fig tree, it says this. Now I've done had the pulpit for 25 minutes, so I'm going to try not to hold you for another hour, and we'll pick up tomorrow night, probably where we left off here tonight. He said that he owned the vineyard, and he wanted fruit 3 years. 3 years it didn't produce, okay? Didn't produce for 3 years, and he said, cut it down. And the keeper, the dresser of it, said, leave it alone for another year. Now, that story right there is teachable. Honestly, if you are an instructor and a pastor, you could take that one parable right there, and I promise you, you could take 6 months of services, and you could teach from that one parable. And I'm going to try to cover those 6 months in the next 30 minutes, all right? So, hang on. When you are reading prophecy, first of all, I believe in Matthew 24, there is more prophecy spoken of in that one chapter. There's more said in that one chapter of the words of Jesus than the entire books of prophecy in the Bible combined. The book of Revelation, Daniel, Ezekiel, Isaiah. Preacher, that's a big statement. Yeah, but you have to understand these are the words of Jesus. And there's so many levels. There's so many different understandings of the Word of God, especially in the Hebrew. And I do not believe that the New Testament was written in Greek. I know that is a common teaching in theology. I do not believe that the New Testament was written in Greek. I believe the New Testament was written in Hebrew, translated to Greek immediately for the language of that day. But the writers of the Word of God are Hebrew men. The writers of the Word of God and those that were converted to Judaism, understand Judaism and the Jewish way of life. Now, there's been a few people, not much, there's been some criticism that there's been some whispers here lately about me and our ministry of how that we're teaching Judaism. That is not true. I'm teaching an understanding of Judaism because, listen closely, I believe that Judaism and Christianity come from the same place. I believe they do. They come from the same root. There's a Jewish artist over in Jerusalem who's in the Jewish quarter there. It's called the Blue and White Gallery. It's an art gallery. He's a very famous artist in Israel there, and we're good acquaintances. I wouldn't say we're running buddies, but good acquaintances with Uday, and he's a great artist. Well, a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago, I guess it was, me and my wife was there in the gallery, and there was a picture of an olive tree that was painted. As a matter of fact, I might have shown that tree to some of y'all in the Garden of Gethsemane, the one that split off last year. I pointed out on the way out because it was we were kind of always behind when we were in Israel. But I pointed out that tree, and Uday's friend had painted this particular tree. And behind the tree in the view, you see the Mount Moriah, the eastern wall of the old city of Jerusalem, the eastern gate, which you can see just on the other side of this painting of the tree. So you know that this painting is looking from the Garden of Gethsemane, looking at the eastern gate, and so you understand what the position of where you are. And my wife Renee asked him, why this tree? And he's kind of smiled and he said, you know, I asked him the same thing. Why this tree? Because it is the only tree that I've found. There's others fine, but it's the only tree, the only olive tree that I've found that is in the form that this one is in. This tree, I'm going to just mark here so y'all understand what I'm saying. It's a little bit of an olive tree like this, and it's got a place in it like this, and then all the leaves are up here, and there's a big bark here and there. There's two different parts of this olive tree. Now, the olive tree don't grow like that. Okay, an olive tree doesn't go like. As a matter of fact, if you don't know anything about an olive tree, you can't graft into an olive tree. You can't take another limb and graft into a limb here. It won't allow it. The only way to graft into an olive tree is you have to graft into the root. And once you graft into the root, then whatever you graft in, it will begin to grow. So my wife was asking him about this tree, and he said, well, I asked my friend why this tree, and in the background was the eastern gate. And he said, well, he explained it to me like this. He said, this tree represents Judaism and Christianity. He said, they began at the same root, and they became divided because of religion, but they're coming back together at the top. Man, my wife, Renee, sitting there, literally, I mean, it caught me by surprise, burst violently, a violent cry, into tears, and because she was so moved by that, because you have to understand what they are looking for. What they are looking for is the same thing we're looking for. We're looking for a Messiah to return. They're looking for him to show up the first time. Now, I've had people say to me, I can't believe that you're friends with rabbis that don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Well, here's what I say. Either myself or my rabbi friends, someday in the near future, one of us is going to have to make a major adjustment. Amen? And I believe it's them. They believe it's me. I'm not going to fight with you about who it is, okay? But I do believe that and this is a statement that I've been sharing across this nation, that you have to understand that Judaism, this is Pastor Hagee's statement, I'll tell you what the Lord brought to me. Pastor Hagee has been sharing for several years now that Judaism does not need Christianity to explain its existence. Judaism does not need Christianity to explain its existence. But Christianity cannot explain its existence without Judaism, because that's the root that we came from, okay? You have to understand that Jesus was not from Kentucky. As helpful as that would have been, okay? He's not from Kentucky. He's not even from Texas. He was a Jewish body, soul, and spirit. Body, soul, and spirit bloodline of the Jewish bloodline, okay? So you have to understand that I've been studying in the past few years trying to understand more about Judaism, because that's where we came from. And this is what I can tell you. If you look at Christianity, that a Messiah came and died upon the cross to restore the kingdom of God, to forgive you of your sins, snatch you, keep you from the horrific judgment of hell. That religion, if you would, of Christianity is incomprehensible. You cannot fully understand Christianity. Christianity is incomprehensible without understanding Judaism. Boy, it gets quiet when I say stuff like that. Christianity is incomprehensible without Judaism, but Judaism is incomplete without Christianity. You understand? Now, there's no need to fuss and fight, because we have three world religions, all right? Major religions. We have Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. All three of those religions have their Bibles. All three of those religions, for hundreds and thousands of years, has had prophets. Now, each religion prophesies, okay? Each religion has prophets that prophesy and those that interpret, theologians, whether you are in Judaism, whether you're in Christianity or in Islam, there are theologians in those, if you would, in those religions that interpret prophecies that have been written hundreds and thousands of years ago. Judaism and Christianity believe that God gives the prophecy and God will bring the prophecy to pass. But Islam believes that God gives prophecy and man must bring it to pass. That's why you're seeing such violence in the Middle East. It's because they believe if they bring about the prophecies that have been spoken, then they usher in their Messiah, the Mahdi. Okay? Now, 4 weeks ago, I just taught a series, and I found out the next day that a Islamic prophet, an Islamic theologian that has studied Islamic prophecies for years, made a statement, and there's now a billboard in Tehran, Iran. There's a billboard in the main square of town. I don't even remember the name of the square. It's a red square keeps coming to mind, and then I was Tiananmen Square, and that's not it. That's in China. So there's a square, okay? And when it's an actual square, no. But it's the county courthouse. You understand what I'm saying? All right. It's the main part of Tehran, and there's a billboard that is there that shows an image of the coming Mahdi. And behind that Mahdi is a picture of Jesus Christ. And Islam believes... Thank you, sir. If you've got a second one, that would be really nice. Amen? You got you one too? Because I'm going to need it. Islam believes, and this is what they teach, okay? That, and they're teaching it right now, that the Messiah, the Mahdi, will show up. Now listen to these numbers. And for 7 years, is going to rule the world. Thank you, Carl. Is going to rule the world under Islamic rule. And at the end of 7 years, Jesus Christ will return. Because they believe Jesus lived. They still believe he was the Son of God. So after 7 years of the Mahdi, go look it up yourself. Don't take my word for it. After 7 years, the Mahdi ruling the world under Islamic rule, that Jesus Christ will return, break the cross, and convert the world to Islam. Now that's their teaching. Now, I want you to listen to this, the similarities. 7 years, the Mahdi is going to rule, and after 7 years, Jesus Christ is going to come back. Does that sound familiar? Now, what they're calling the Mahdi, we call the Antichrist. Are you seeing this? Okay? And this is what they're teaching. There's a billboard in Tehran, Iran, right now. Okay? So, Bill Cowell, what's this got to do with wherever we are? Everything is coming so fast. Events are happening so fast, it's very difficult to even stay up with it because so much is happening in prophecy. When you saw the planets, Jupiter and Venus, lining up just recently, you could see it here in Kentucky. Guys, I won't even get into it. Sam and I have been talking back and forth, and sometimes Sam, when he texts you, it's like a novel. You just have to keep scrolling. That's fine. And, you know, and sometimes, a lot of times, I don't even answer back. Number one, because I need to sit down just a minute and run through scriptures. And secondly, because sometimes I answer return text in my head and days go by before I realize I didn't actually return it. So anybody know what I'm talking about, okay? And so understand, there's so much that's happening so fast. But I want to go back to right here to these scriptures, to what I read to you tonight. In Matthew chapter 24... Let me read this. Matthew chapter number 24 and verse number 32. Bible says, "Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise, ye, when ye shall see these things, know that it is near, even at the door. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled." Now, I could get into the, you know, splitting hairs here. The word properly translated is not "this generation." The proper translation is "these generations shall not pass." What generations? That begin to see these things fulfilled. I truly believe that we're looking at a time frame for the return of Jesus Christ to rule and reign this planet from this point right here. I believe we're looking at a time frame from anywhere to 12 months to 8 years. That's what I believe. Preacher, you're trying to box Jesus in. No. He could be here tonight. I got that. He could return tonight. But we have shouted for so long about the rapture of the church and the dead resurrected, and we going out there to live forever. We've just shouted over top of what real truth is.
Amen.
Okay? And once again, if you're standing on truth, when the world moves, you don't stay there and move away from the truth. You have to know what truth is. Okay? Now, we've quoted for years that the truth will set you free. That is incorrect. Okay? The Bible doesn't say anything about truth setting you free. It says you have to know the truth. And the truth that you know will set you free. And we're not talking about people's ideas. We're not talking about people's opinions. But we're talking about truth. And the Bible is self-explanatory. You just have to see exactly what it says. Now, I'm not talking about the King James English. If you read an NIV in some parts of the South, or if you read English Standard, you're going to hell. Because, the old-timers and some of them and some of the new-timers. Well, I want to stick with the original, the King James. Okay, number one, you don't know split beans from coffee. Secondly, the original was not King James. The original was Hebrew. If you want to understand the original, then you need to learn how to read Hebrew, okay? And so here we have a statement that Jesus says, you have to understand, Matthew 24, and I'm trying to very, very methodically go here because I don't lose anybody, so don't go to sleep on me. Is anybody bored? Am I boring y'all to tears? Okay, good. All right, good. I knew I wasn't. I'm just looking for a cheap amen. Matthew chapter 24 is prophecy. And Jesus says, in the last days, in the time of prophecy, he says, if you want to know about prophecy, if you want to know what is going on in prophecy, you need to know and learn the parable of the fig tree. Okay, that's what he says. Now understand that one other place it is talked about, fig tree and other trees. But the only parable recorded from the words of Jesus about a fig tree starts in Luke 13 and verse 6 that I read to you about the fig tree in the vineyard. Okay? Now, let me go quick. Do we have an eraser here? Well, I drew a tree and now I can't erase it. We're gonna get there. You go. Brother Joe, you are my new friend. Okay, yeah, just got one. Yeah. Hard times at the house of prayer. All right. Well, thank you for that, Brother Joe. If you wasn't married, I'd propose. All right. That's not even funny nowadays, is it? No, I'm sorry, Joe. You can stay your distance. All right. Now, oh, look here. She's my new friend. You're out. All right. Change. Yeah, just like you and then don't like you. Reminds you of a lot of church people, doesn't it? All right, now, in prophecy, you have to understand, guys, that in prophecy, you have the word they. Now, this is in our God's Time Clock series. Those of you watching online, if you want the God's Time Clock series, we have it out here in the foyer if you want it. You go to randycaldwell.com and you can purchase it there. God's number of completion is 7, and I'm not going to reteach what I taught here last year, the whole thing about the 6-day process. But you have to understand, in prophecy, when you find the word day, this is very important. The word day or week or, usually day or week. When you see the word day, you have to know whether they're talking about a 24-hour period, whether they're talking about a 7-day week, a 30-day month, a 360-day year. The word day can represent a 10-year period, a decade. The word day can represent a millennium, 1,000 years, a century, 100 years, or even 50 years as a jubilee. The word day. So you have to know exactly what the word day is meaning. All right? The word year, the word day, the word week in prophecy can all be transposed. All right? in the parable of the fig tree, he says, for 3 years, this fig tree has not produced fruit. All right, now, God works 6 days. There's 13 steps of creation, okay? 13 steps of creation in Genesis chapter number 1. Now, I find it astounding. I just find it astounding that now the new talk is, the new talk all over is, you know, that theologians are even coming to the realization, you know, well, they have almost proven now that the universe began with the Big Bang. And guys, look at me. I'm not going to argue with you about that. I'll argue with you about that. Is it possible that our universe began with the Big Bang? Absolutely. But when it went bang, God done it. Okay? I'm not going to argue with you about how God done it. But I do know that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Amen. That's it. And there's 13 steps to creation in Genesis chapter number 1. There's 13 different steps in 6 days. In case you've never heard me tell this, it bears repeating this because of our internet audience right now. The question was proposed a few years ago, what are the chances that Moses, who wrote Genesis chapter 1, he wrote the book of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers, Deuteronomy, Moses, is 2,000 years removed from Adam being put in the Garden of Eden. 2,000 years down the road, Moses shows up. So what are the chances that a man, 2,000 years after something happens, could write about that event and get all 13 steps exactly right? Now, if you don't believe that the Bible is correct, if you believe there's errors in the Word of God, and this just blows my mind. People say, well, you know, the Bible contradicts itself. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. People say, well, you know, the Bible and scientists run head to head. Science and the Bible run head to head. No, they don't. Science and the Word of God contradict. No, they don't. See, God's Word is God's Word, out of His mouth, spoken, written by men. Now, most rabbinical theologians believe that God hand-wrote Genesis chapter 1 Himself on stone on Mount Sinai and gave it to Moses. That's what my Hebrew rabbi friends believe. Now, I can't prove that, but most likely that's what happened. But here's the question. If it was Moses writing, what are the chances 2,000 years after these events took place that Moses could write Genesis chapter 1 starting in verse 2 through verse number 31 and get them exactly right 2,000 years after that happened? The chances are 1 to 32 sectillion. Now that's a lot. Okay? How big is 32 sectillion? It's a 32 with a comma and 21 zeros behind it. How big is that number? It's bigger than a national deficit. Which is even hard to wrap your mind around. Okay? Did you know they took all the tax dollars in 2016 that are paid from the Mississippi River, north and south of the United States, Mississippi River east, all the tax dollars that are paid would not pay off the national deficit. That's how bad we're in debt. You're $16, $17 trillion in debt. $17 trillion in debt. Okay, number one, why do you still have a checkbook? Okay? Because you bounce a $5 check at your bank and they're going to take your checkbook, all right? So how big is 32 sectillion? 32 with 21 zeros behind it. Now, this is what would happen. If there was going to be a lottery ticket that was going to be printed, there's one winning ticket out of 32 sectillion, okay? They're going to print 32 sectillion lottery tickets. And when they get done printing 32 sectillion lottery tickets, you get one chance to draw the winning ticket. You need 8 million printing presses printing 2,000 tickets a minute. 8 million printing presses printing 2,000 tickets a minute for 5 million years. And after 5 million years of 8 million printing presses printing 2,000 tickets a minute, you get one chance to draw the winning ticket. That's the same chances that Moses had of writing Genesis chapter 1. There might be a divine hand afoot here. What do you think? Amen. Hand afoot. See how I done that? See how I thought it in there? Okay? Now watch. Okay? If you don't believe in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, then we're done. We're finished. I taught this on TBN here. Matter of fact, I don't know if you saw the program, me and Brother Perry Stone and Brother Kevin also saw that. I made mention of this. You have to understand that Genesis chapter 1 is a Bible by itself. Genesis 1 and verse 2 through verse 31 goes back to verse 1. Genesis chapter 2 through chapter 50 goes back to chapter 1. And Exodus chapter 1 through Revelation 22 goes back to Genesis. So Exodus, Revelation, back to Genesis. Chapter 2 through chapter 50, back to chapter 1. Verse 2 through 31, back to verse 1. If you can't get past in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, we're done. Have nothing left to discuss. Science and the Bible contradict. No, they don't. Scientists and preachers contradict. Confusing science and scientists with preachers and church is like confusing God with his people. If you ever confuse God with his people, you're messed up right from the beginning, okay? Now, in prophecy, day, week, year, they're all transposed, okay? So he says, first of all, 6 days he worked and rested on the seventh. Wow, thank you, Holy Ghost. Why is there such a big argument? The Sabbath day is Saturday or Sunday. Why is there such an argument? The Sabbath day is Saturday. Sunday is the first day of the week. In the 1500s, the Catholic Church got up and said, the Sabbath is Sunday. They changed the rule. And take you right back to the day they done it. They changed it and went, that's not the Sabbath day. That's the first day of the week. The Sabbath day is on Saturday. Well, then we shouldn't be working on Saturday. Remember, the Sabbath day and keep it holy didn't have anything to do with working. That was the law. Remember, the Sabbath day and keep it holy was honoring the day. Take some time off out of 7 days to spend a little time resting. I'm preaching myself right now, right? To spend a little time resting and spend some time with your family. Okay? Talk to your wife. Talk to your husband. You know? How's your husband doing? Well, he's still living. Old bird's still kicking. Okay. Don't amen at the wrong time, all right? I'm not even going to tell you what's going on up on his second seat up here, all right? Look here. Remember, the Sabbath day and keep it holy was not about not making fire. What God gave him instruction to do was not work on that day. They're in the middle of the desert. He didn't want them picking up manna on that. He says, take a day off. Take a day and spend some time. Out of 7 days, pick you a day. Because the law was fulfilled. Oh, we into something up in here tonight, amen? So stop arguing with Saturday and Sunday nonsense. Well, when is the Sabbath? The Sabbath is the Sabbath day is the seventh day. Sabbath day. Sabbath. Okay, Sunday is the first day. Can you not count? Your mother dropped you on your head and you never got over it. Stop arguing over religious things. Okay? So 6 days and take a day off. 1 day is 1,000 years. 1,000 years is 1 day. I believe there will be 6,000 years of mankind toiling. And the 7,000 year, the seventh millennium from Adam, the seventh day, 1 day being 1,000 years from Adam, will be the millennial reign for 1,000 years. The devil will be bound and there will be peace on this planet. And Jesus Christ will sit on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, ruling this planet. And the lion in Africa will lay down beside the lamb. And the child will stick his hand in the hole of a cobra. And it will not bite him for 1,000 years. Okay? And we are fastly approaching. So watch. If you have this right here, 4 days, in Genesis chapter number 1, the end of the fourth day, God puts the sun in the sky. I teach this in our series. He puts the sun in the sky. After 4,000 years, the Word becomes the Son of God, okay, on planet Earth. There's always a pattern there. I'm not going to reteach that tonight. But watch closely. Did God create the earth? Yes or no? Did God create the universe? Did God create the sun and moon and stars? Did God create air? Did God create the birds and the fish and the fowl? And, yeah. Did God cause plants to grow? Did God create, did God form Adam and Eve? Did God create the Garden of Eden? No, he didn't. No, because I didn't taught you that one. All right? God did not create the Garden of Eden. God did not create the Garden of Eden. God planted a garden. There's a difference. Okay? Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. Man breathed the man the breath of life. Man became a living soul. Verse 8. Boom. And the Lord God planted a garden. The first thing that God taught, body, soul, and spirit, human race, the first thing God taught Adam was not about how to build a church. He didn't teach him about the synagogue and the tallit. He didn't teach him about the shofar. He didn't teach him about the plan of salvation. The first thing that God taught Adam was sowing and reaping. And as long as the earth remaineth, what shall remain? Seed time. See, you know, what we say is seed time and harvest. But this is what I've come to discover. These three things, not two. Seed, time, and harvest. If you plant seed, there's got to be time before you get a harvest. Well, a preacher said, if I tithe, God bless me. I tithe last week and nothing happened so far this week. Because anything that comes up overnight is not a seed, it's a weed. And if you give Caldwell time, he'll get around to money sooner or later. All right, look here. If you understand that when you sow, you shall reap. Amen? Okay, now watch. Man, so, you love it. You don't know Jehu Hughes. You just love it. Amen? He loves to watch me flow in this. Now watch. If you have this set up, 6 days working and resting on the seventh, I believe the 7,000 year being the limit of rain, then that means 4,000 years, 4,000 years from Adam, 4,000 years from Adam, the Word became flesh. Okay? 4,000 years. Now, get you some oxygen. Breathe deep. Jesus Christ dying on the cross was not the original plan of God. But Cole, what are you talking about? Bible says the Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world. Yeah, the reason you're a little bit confused about it is because you've always been taught that the word foundation means beginning of time. That is not what that word means. The word foundation, every time in the New Testament, when it says foundation of the world, is the Greek word katabole, katabole. And you're going to have to be an adult, okay? Because this is exactly what the word means. It means the fertilization of the seed of man into the womb of the woman. The Lamb was slain. The plan for the Lamb to die was put into action when man began to reproduce upon the earth. Because the original plan was not for Jesus Christ to come and die upon a cross. The original plan was for Adam and Eve to have dominion, to multiply, and to rule and reign over this planet and not fall. I see some of y'all just wiping tears. Thank you for that. I'm glad that stirs you. All right? Because that was the original plan of God. Was for not for man to fall, but for man to have dominion. So now, man did fall. And God sets a plan into action. And everybody always wants to know. Okay? When I teach, we are going to teach this whole seminar starting August the 19th at, if you're in Houston, Texas, we're going to start it, and we're going to start August 19th, four consecutive Wednesday nights at the Hilton Hotel, at the ballroom at the Hilton Hotel, open to the public starting next month. Keep us in your prayers for that, okay? Because people want to know where that we are. And Jesus said, if you want to know about end times, know about the parable of the fig tree. So let's look at it. This day that Jesus taught this parable, a few things happened. First of all, he said, for 3 years, watch, for 3 years, the tree did not produce fruit. God has always, from the very beginning, before the fall of man, wanted a harvest. Sowing and reaping is not a church law. It's not a Christian law. It's a God law. And if you want a harvest, you have to plant.
Amen.
That's it. I carry with me in my briefcase sometimes, and I taught it, I think, last time I was here on Sunday morning, but I carry with me packs of seed.
Yep.
I carry with them. I've got green beans over here. I think I got green beans, and I got corn. I said, oh, the green beans is in the back. I might have left it at the room. But I carry the packages with me. Now, here they are, right here. This is green beans. And this is corn. And this is seed. There's not a doubt in your mind, not one of you. If you plant that right there, you're not going to get strawberries. You're going to get corn. That right there don't grow cucumbers or carrots. That's going to grow green beans. Every one of you know that. As a matter of fact, if you're really slow and dumb, they got a picture of the United States on the back. And it's color-coded. And you can find your state. And right over here it tells you when you need to plant it. If you live in Kentucky, you need to plant it between May and June. That's when you need to put it in the ground. And you know it's going to... Look here. Why? Because seed does not do anything except bring a harvest. That's it. That's all it does. That's what seed does. It don't dance. It don't sing. It don't drive cars. Seeds grow. That's what they do. They opened up King Tut's tomb, 3,000-year-old tomb, and found wheat germ seed in the dried, in the, you know, because of the dry climate there, dried wheat germ, 3,000 years old, took them out, planted them, and they grew. That's what seed does. And you know it. And the Bible makes it very clear that the Word of God is the seed. If you can believe that package will bring a harvest, why can't you believe that'll bring a harvest? Seed is seed. And God says, the first thing I want you to know is I want a harvest. And he planted a garden and caused it to grow. Jesus said, if you want to know about where we are and the last days, know about the fig tree. And the parable says, for 3 years, or transpose it, 3,000 years, there is no fruit. Mankind is producing no harvest for the world. Oh, we had a little Judaism going on. A little fellow named Moses, Abraham, Moses, all right in here. And Jesus said that the end times, you will know where we are in this last days, know this story. For 3 years, 3,000 years, nothing happened. Cut it down. And the keeper of the vineyard said, wait a minute. Well, which by the way, there's a little fellow born right here, 3,000 years from Adam by the name of David, who was a man after God's own heart. And the keeper says, hold on. Let's let it go for one more year, one more 1,000 years. And if we get fruit then, awesome. If we don't, we'll cut the thing down and start over. Well, guess what happened right here? The Son of God showed up that extra year. If you want to know about the end times, know about this story. And so he tells that story, and then he says, there's a woman. Immediately, a woman that shows up who's the daughter of Abraham. And she's bound for 18 years. Now watch, 18, that's our word in English. The word in Greek is deca okto, 10-8. Now, deca-okto in Greek is the word for 18, but it's still two words. It's not one word like we have. We have 10 and 8, but we have 18. In Greek, 18 is 10 and 8. So there's a new beginning at 8. So what happens at 10 is the end of testing. Now watch close. Because I know I was going to quit at 40 minutes and we have surpassed it. So you think it's just stinking easy, come up here and give it a shot yourself. All right? If you want to know about the end times, know what happened on the day I told the parable about the fig tree. And the only day he told a parable about a fig tree is the day a woman shows up who's been head to toe for 18 years. And he laid his hands on her and she was straightened up. Now we Pentecostals used to sing a song. I'm glad I moved from Crooked Street to Glory Avenue. No mortgage on your property, no taxes ever come due. The sun is always shining there, and the sky is always blue. I'm glad I moved from Crooked Street to Glory Avenue. There was a woman who lived on Crooked Street. Her head was bound down to her feet. It tells about this woman right here for 18 years. Never mind. All right? So watch what happens in this story. This woman gets healed after 18 years. And the church world, the ruler of the synagogue says, 6 days, come in and come and be healed. Rest on, see, he's hung up on this. Okay? He's hung up on this mess. Watch. The law was fulfilled, not done away with. You still need a day that you can rest and have some family time. You need that. Okay? He didn't do away with it. He fulfilled it, gave it more meaning. Okay? If you want to rest on Sunday, but I can tell you, our Sunday, our day of rest, can wear you out. Well, the day of rest, you shouldn't work. Go to church twice a day and go eat Sunday afternoon. You are wore out come Monday morning. You got to go to work to get some rest. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Amen? All right, watch. So, the ruler of the synagogue says, 6 days, 6 days can a man work. Come and be healed in that day. Watch the numbers. If you want to know about the end times, go see what I said on the day I told the parable of the fig tree. Right? Now watch. How many years from Adam to Jesus? How many years? Okay, well, y'all quick. 4,000. 4,000 years. Okay? Son of man. So now we're dealing with a parable about Jesus. And he says, if you want to know about end times, go see what happened. And that story, and then he says, I told this in the synagogue. And as soon as I told it, has a woman been over, but you know, like the TV preachers, be healed. You know what I'm saying? Never mind. That's a joke for the Northerners. Never mind. Not quite up high enough for y'all to get that joke, am I? Now watch. 6 days. 1 day is what? So in this story, we have 6,000 years and we have 18 years. So that's 6,018 years, correct? In the year of 2001, we begin our 7,000th millennium from Adam. 1,000 years from the year of 2001 will be 7,000 years from Adam. Okay? So that means at the end, December 31st of the year of 2000, we were 4,000 years to Jesus, 2,000 years from Jesus to us, which gives us 6,000 years, which would have been the year of 2000 and when it ended, the beginning of the year of 2001. So in this story, you have 6,000 years, but you have 18 years. So that brings us, if you start with 2000, to the year of 2018. in this story. Stay. Some churches, Preacher, this is 2015. You're right. When the cycle of 2018 begins in the fall of the year, I believe with all of my heart, I stand in front of you, that the Israeli people and as a whole nation, by the end of that 2018 year cycle, will have to come to know that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. Starting in the fall of 2018. Preacher, what are you saying? I'm getting to that. So that means, watch. Jesus said that this generation, these generations, look for a sign. But no sign shall be given unto this adulterous and perverse generation except the sign. Somebody help me. The sign of Jonah. Now wait a minute. Jesus said, watch, last days, that this generation in the last days is looking for this adulterous and perverse generation is looking for a sign, and there'll be no sign given. Except the sign of Jonah. Sign of what? Sign of Jonah. What's the sign of Jonah? That the last days, that generation is coming to an end. We're done. It's finished. When they see the sign of Jonah. Now, hold your thought. There are certain names in our culture that provoke laughter. Like Bruce Jenner. Oh, come on, you know what I'm talking about. An Olympic athlete on a box of Wheaties. Now they're going to put him on Fruit Loops, but that's a whole nother story. I'm away from the pulpit, all right? Oh, you should be loving and... No. That is idiotic. Amen. That is idiotic. And every television station is singing the praise of it. Can I get, will y'all allow me to get really blunt? Thank you, because I'm going to anyway. Here's the rule. If you're male or if you're female, here's the rule. If you were born with a uterus, you're female. If not, move on, you ain't. That's it. That's the rule. Shut up, that's the rule. Well, I feel, I don't care how you feel, that is the rule. And a lot of rules we may have moved away from, but I'm standing on that one. That's it. That's it. There are names that can provoke laughter like Michael Jackson. Great guy, great singer. Had some issues, not a great guy in some ways. Great singer, great musician, incredible talent, but you know, you climb trees in your pajamas, you've snapped. Al Gore. You have said nothing, just don't say anything else, just say the name, enough said. The inventor of the internet. Tries to take credit for everything. He tried to take credit for who let the dogs out. Do you remember who let the dogs? Okay, he wanted. All right. In the early 90s, in 1995, I remember specifically the year that they told us by 2010, 15 years away, global warming is moving so fast that by 2010, the polar caps would be melted. Ocean levels would be 3 to 4 feet higher. The east and west coast would mostly disappear. Florida would become all swampland. And the ocean's going to rise. It's 2015. I'll wait. Because in 1995, they started promoting global warming. Okay. Global warming. Now, I'm not an English teacher, but I think warming means to get warmer. Are you with me on that one? Okay, not a stretch. I got you. All right. Over $50 billion has been spent in the last 20 years to study global warming. The last three winters have been so cold. If the earth gets any warmer, we're going to freeze to death. So global warming doesn't seem to be working out. So now they don't say that anymore. Now it's climate change. You're an idiot. You just change the rules. You just make stuff up. Do you people understand? We have videotape. Do you understand that? We know what you said. I mean, how big of an... Stop it, Randy. I'm about to snap. Okay? So here's the deal. The polar ice caps at this juncture in 2015 are frozen thicker than they've ever been in recorded history. After $50 billion in study of climate change, this pretty much is what they've come up with. Sometimes it gets really hot in the summer and really cold in the winter. Sometimes. Now, I heard a news commentator say on the news last winter, I heard this on ears, this climate change is getting worse. This is the third coldest winter we've had on record. So you mean there was two colder than this one? And they were in the 1800s. Hey, goober, sometimes it gets cold in the winter. Yeah, there's climate change because the climate changes. Go look at the hieroglyphics of the Native Americans in Texas. Back in the 1700s, you translate them, it says, man, it's hot in Texas in the summer. This is what it says. I'm sorry, I made that up. Sometimes I just say things. All right, now. In 2010, the polar caps did melt. What are you talking about, preacher? Remember the sign of Jonah? What's the sign of Jonah? The gray whale. Jonah was swallowed by the gray whale. Swallowed him up. Okay? And he puked him back up and he lived. Now, you know he's a Pentecostal preacher. You know he was. Because he was in the whale's belly for 3 days before he decided to pray. I saw that whale open his mouth and I started sliding down that tongue. I'd have grabbed that little hanging down thing and hung on there. Help me, Jesus. I know you're not here for another 1,000 years, but help me, Jesus. Noah began to pray because, you know, the digestive juices would have had to have been working on him in 3 days' time. And so he began to realize he's coming out of the whale. One direction or the other, all right? No. All right, this is true. All right, now watch. Preacher, do you really believe a man could literally be... Do you believe that was a literal thing? I do. Let me tell you why. In the late 1800s, a young man, 19 years old, by the name of James Bartley, was from England. And he was on a whaling ship. Now, I wasn't there. This is a story that was reported in the paper. They still have copies of the paper. He joined the whaling ship. They were down past the southern tip of South America because in the 1600s, 1700s, the gray whale was hunted to extinction in the Atlantic Ocean. The gray whale has not been in the Atlantic Ocean for 300 plus years. Okay? The gray whale, the kind that swallowed Jonah. James Bartley was on a whaling ship. the southern tip of South America. They launched out the boats to harpoon the whale after it was spotted. James Bartley and two other men was in one of the boats. They harpooned the whale. He done his flop. The tail came up, caught the boat that James Bartley was in. All three men were thrown into the Pacific Ocean. Two of them was recovered, and they didn't find James Bartley. Wrote him off for drowning. They killed the whale. 2 days later, as they're cutting the whale open, dissecting, they got to the stomach, and they saw something moving, and they cut it open, and it was James Bartley. He was blind. All the hair had been dissolved off of his body, and his skin was bleached, and he was blind. But he lived. In a few days in the captain's quarters, he was back on deck helping. And when the boat went back to England, he lived to be an older man and died. And on his tombstone in England, it tells the story of a modern day Jonah. Go look it up. James Bartley, write it down. Now, I wasn't there. That's what was reported in the paper. Okay? Young man goes, he comes back, he's bleached white, and all the hairs are moved, and he's blind. Something happened. Okay? Now, Jonah was swallowed by the gray whale. The Mediterranean Ocean, Mediterranean Sea, that Jonah was in, is off the coast of Joppa. How many went to Israel with us? Raise your hand. Who went to Israel with us in this building? Raise your hand. Okay, y'all remember the first place I took you was to the port of Joppa. Y'all remember that? Joe, y'all remember that? Okay. The port of Joppa. Okay. And the original port that Jonah sailed from, it isn't working now. It's just all stone, but it's still there. Okay. That's the Mediterranean Sea. Now watch. Watch. Everybody look here. Here's Israel. Okay. Here's Israel. Here's the Mediterranean Sea. This is Africa over here, and this is starting Europe over here, and you got Spain. Here's the Atlantic Ocean, okay? The only way into here to get to Israel's coast is from the Atlantic Ocean. The gray whales have been extinct for 350 years. The only place that gray whales are found on this planet is off the coast of California and Canada and Alaska, and there's a pod over by Russia. The only place they're found. Is God in control of our weather? You better know it. May the 9th of 2010, 1 mile off the coast of Tel Aviv, which is Joppa, a gray whale showed up. May the 9th of 2010, a gray whale showed up 1 mile off the coast of Israel, which is this right there, the port of Joppa, where Jonah sailed from. Scientists, marine biologists, goes nuts. And they start flying to Tel Aviv from around the world. And they've got pictures and movies and, thank you, sir. Right there it is. That's the picture. It's May the 9th, 2010. Was I correct? Thank you very much. Watch. See that city in the background? That's Tel Aviv. Right off to the right, that's Jaffa, where Jonah sailed from. They've been extinct for 350 years. Marine biologists show up and study this thing. May the 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, and 13th. 5 days, number of grace. 5 days. And he's not seen again after the 13th of May of 2010. The 14th of May is Israel's anniversary. Now let me tell you what the rabbis say. When they say the third sign of Jonah, when you see in prophecy for years, the third sign of Jonah begins the Jewish restoration. And at the end of the Jewish restoration, the Messiah shows up. The first and second sign of Jonah has already happened. They were waiting on the third sign of Jonah, and that happened May the 9th, watch, of 2000. If you want to know about the end times, go see what happened on that day I told the parable of the fig tree. Deca octo, 10 and 8, two numbers. Watch. How in the world did the whale get there? The only way that whale could have made that journey, the only possible way, marine biologists said, the polar ice caps had melted so bad that it opened up a path for him to swim from around Alaska and Russia over by Greenland and Iceland, past 21 countries, and nobody saw him. This is not a beetle bug. That thing's the size of a hotel. A mammal the size of a small hotel goes past 21 countries and nobody sees it until it gets 1 mile off the coast of Tel Aviv. What a coincidence. This generation looks for a sign, but this generation of the last days will not receive a sign except for the sign of Jonah. And that, rabbis in Israel say, was the third sign of Jonah. And new beginnings is after 8 years. Deca Octo brings you to 2018. Nothing? Hey, watch. What are you saying, preacher? Jesus is coming. Jesus said, if you want to know about the end times, go look and see what happened today. What happened that day? 6,000 plus 18. And he's teaching about the last days. Now, you may think that is a coincidence, but you better hear me. Lord, protect me. The Clinton Initiative Foundation is an organization that I'm sure does a lot of good. God bless them. Okay? There's a man, unnamed, on the board of the Clinton Foundation, Initiative Foundation, who was on a PAC board. Some say still is. I don't have proof of that. But was on a PAC board that made a resolution to the UN a few years ago. The resolution was tabled. The resolution has come back to life, and they're wanting the UN to vote on this resolution. What is it? To make Jerusalem an international city. Listen, not owned by the Jews, not owned by the Palestinians, not owned by any country. But Jerusalem, in the UN resolution, is to become an international city, to have a czar appointed over the city to overlook this international city, and the czar is to be appointed by the Pope. Is anybody awake?
Yes, sir.
If you think we're just playing tiddlywinks, honey, you better wake up and smell the coffee.
Amen.
This thing is moving so fast. We're coming to such a close that I'm afraid the majority of the church world is asleep at the wheel.
Amen.
They're slumbering and sleeping when the cry has gone out, the bridegroom cometh. In case you haven't heard, the midnight cry is not the coming of the Messiah. That was the cry that he's coming. Tomorrow night, I'm going to show you that for the last 500 years, God has been sending text messages. Not to your iPhone. Just use that to get your attention. God has been sending messages through the sun, the moon, and the stars. And we will show you what has been discovered for the last 500 years and what is found that they say God is screaming from the heavens that he's coming. Get everybody here tomorrow night that you can get here. But for tonight, I'm done. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise.